All right, folks, we're going to go ahead and get started with our second panel. If you guys could please take your seats and make sure that there's room for the folks in standing in the back to take a seat. We'll get going. So, was that not amazing information? Did anyone write down their predictions to see if they're going to be right for next year? My name is Mackenzie Carolan, Vice President of Business Development for Linbeck, and we're thrilled to be the market sector sponsor this year. I know we just learned a whole bunch from our previous panel, but I'm going to bring up on stage our next panel for the big idea. Each of our panelists had created a list of at least one, if not more than one, big idea in Fort Worth, and we are going to spend the next hour learning from them while accepting their challenge to us that more big ideas are coming to Fort Worth. Please welcome Mike Berry with Hillwood, Laura Bird with Anthracite Realty Partners and Jetta, Craig Cavileer with Majestic Realty, Crawford Edwards with Cassco, and Isaac Manning with Trinity Works up to the stage. This panel will be moderated by none other than the fabulous Robert Allen, the new president and CEO of the Fort Worth Economic Development Partnership. Please sit back and get ready for a ride because this discussion is going to be a great one. If you weren't bullish on growth and development in Fort Worth, you certainly will be after this discussion.
Well, good morning. Mackenzie, thank you very much. I appreciate that kind introduction. As Mackenzie said, I'm Robert Allen, and I have the honor and privilege to moderate this conversation today. And I was talking to my wife last night, had her look at some of these questions, and I said, I don't know what they were thinking. They're asking me to try to keep these five luminary, visionary thoroughbreds on the right track today. So bear with me. I'm going to do my best to try to make sure that we stay focused on talking about the big ideas in Tarrant County, which is what this panel is about. You heard a lot of really positive information in the previous panel, and I want you to think for just a second. I moved to Fort Worth not even a year ago, so I may be the newest member of the community in the room, but as I was researching this and I was putting together questions for this panel, the city of Fort Worth, the skyline of Fort Worth, and the anchors and attractants of Fort Worth that each of these individuals have had their hands on would be and look very, very different if they had not done what they did. So you heard throughout the previous conversation lots of references to their projects. We'll get into those in a minute. But I want you to think about that as we go forward in this conversation. What if they hadn't done what they've done? What would Fort Worth look like today? I can assure you that conversation would be very different and it wouldn't be a lot of fun. So we got an hour in front of us. I'm going to do my best to get through this. So sit back, relax, and enjoy. Laura, I want to come to you first because I was raised in the South and ladies always go first. You were responsible for the last big office addition in downtown Fort Worth at 640 Taylor Street. I visit often. Thank you very much for that. You said in 2016, and I quote, the building was a no-brainer, end quote. One, why was it a no-brainer, but also why Fort Worth, Laura?
So the no-brainer comment, I think, came from we had, you know, look at the history of Fort Worth, the 30 years in downtown prior to 2010 is when we kind of got the ideas. The Star Telegram had the properties for sale that we kind of had our eye on. We ended up being second bidder on that, so it delayed the project for 5 years. Until we could convince the first bidder who ended up with the property that we were a good partner or a good person to sell to. And we kind of had our eye on that property. Before that, we had done, to house our company, Jetta Operating Company, we had looked to all the different subsectors, the market, moving out west, moving north, and we just decided downtown was the place that we really wanted to make our home. And so the no-brainer comment, I think, was, and then look at all the cities outside of Fort Worth and what they were doing at that time. You started getting amenity-rich, very Class A, Class AA buildings in Austin, Dallas, Houston. And so we looked to that. We did a lot of site visits to a lot of those properties and finally figured out, you know, that's what we want to do. That's what we want to bring to our home, to Fort Worth, is this amenity-rich that really embraces the tenant wholly and looked at health and wellness to the tenant, looked at all of our HVAC systems, our lighting, that kind of thing. We really wanted to make it the place that we created a neighborhood around for our tenants. And so that was how Frost Tower was born. And of course, we needed our great tenants, the lead of being Frost. I mean, they have the same corporate culture that we do and love the fact that they're in the building. Helps our other tenants because they have a retail location right downstairs, Palmwood, the event center, our restaurant. We have a workout facility for our people and the parking right there in the garage. So all of those things were really important to us to create that kind of environment that Fort Worth didn't already have.
It's a good point, and I know Hadley was in the room somewhere with Frost, but it's a good point, that fit, that feel that is so important, and I've certainly felt it here in Fort Worth since I've been here. It's critically important. Isaac, I'm going to come to you next. You've had your hand in and worked on numerous projects with several of the individuals on this stage, which I think is going to be fun for us to explore. Whether it's Mike and Hillwood, whether it's Crawford and the Edward Ranch team, now you're focusing a lot of your effort and time on 7,200 acres out west with the Walsh Ranch. So how would you answer the why Fort Worth question if somebody approached you on the street and said, why Fort Worth?
The why Fort Worth piece is, I think, the most critical question that we've got to deal with today. You know, years ago when we were working on the Victory Project over in Dallas, Ron Kirk asked me, he said, Isaac, why do you live in Fort Worth? And it's like, Ron, because I had a choice. You know, there are a lot of people in the room that are not as old as we are on the stage today, but you know, Fort Worth, when I got here in 1989, stopped at 820. The outer universe was Fossil Creek and Mercantile. People don't realize that the public-private partnership between Alliance, the City of Fort Worth, and the FAA enabled Fort Worth to double its growth and geographical area in a single day. So forget all the great stuff that Mike and the Alliance team have done over the last 35 plus years. The biggest reason that we're the 12th largest city in the country is because of that attitude and our ability to do public-private partnership in this town. The second thing I'll say about Fort Worth and why Fort Worth is sitting next to me, Crawford Edwards' dad in the late 50s, early 60s, did a handshake deal with the mayor of Fort Worth at the time and said, when you guys are ready to build the Southwest Freeway, the land will be there. The Edwards stopped developing in the 80s and left 1,000 acres open. That was 6.8 miles of the Southwest Freeway on a handshake agreement. Who does that? The stewardship of the Edwards family of that land since 1848 has been a remarkable thing for this town. The last piece of this is, I was rolling back off Arizona State's football stadium, which I swear to God I'll never do another sports venue after that deal. But the Walsh family approached me and said, hey, we've got 7,500 acres out here. I hadn't really spent any time thinking about it. What's really interesting about the why Fort Worth piece is when we started Alliance over 35 years ago, it was the great unknown. Think about 820 and going out in 20 and 30. What's super cool about that part of town is that you have over 24,000 acres of land in the hands of 7 or 8 families. So like the Edwards and what they've been able to do, the Beggs, the Veals, the, you know, just all of the ranching families out there have been able, the Murrins have been able to hold that land together. So our future in terms of being able to go west, first of all, I love really large land stuff. I love it when it's really complicated. But that's a hell of an opportunity for a run that's going to live long past me. So why Fort Worth? Love this place.
Well said. And I liked how you started. You know, you had a choice. Everybody does have a choice. They choose for different reasons. And when we talk again back to big ideas, 24,000 acres is a big idea. And what that could afford in terms of run rate for Fort Worth, the western side of the Metroplex is phenomenal. It's transformative, frankly. Perfect bridge, Crawford, to you, sir. you know, again, back to my research for this, I'm a student of history, so I try to dig in and understand some of the facts as quickly as I could. It is difficult to wrap your head around, for me it was, the notion that the Edwards Ranch was first homesteaded in 1848 on 640 acres. And so for you, the why Fort Worth question may be obvious to some, but for those that may not be familiar with that long legacy in history, why Fort Worth with that portion aside? Does that make sense?
You bet. Well, thank you, Robert. And Isaac, thank you very much for those comments. Isaac, as you may know, was instrumental in the genesis of Clear Fork from really day one. And I won't go into the details of how we met and grew into a great relationship. And thank you for that. Why Fort Worth? Well, Fort Worth, as you know, we all know the great attributes it has, the locations and the entertainment, pro-business. We know all that, and it's very diversified, which I think is fantastic for you know, future growth. But really what I think sets Fort Worth apart from a lot of cities is its heritage, its friendliness, it's genuine, and it's just a great place, including the fact that it's a friendly town. We know cities, and I'll pick on Austin, maybe even Nashville a little bit, they've grown exponentially, and they're great cities, but they're unmanageable, and they're just not friendly. Austin used to be very friendly. Now it's just, I know a lot of Californians have moved in, et cetera, et cetera. Nothing against them. but it's just changed. And I think the challenge for Fort Worth, or at least from my perspective, is we want growth. There's no doubt about that. We want to have sustained growth so we avoid the pitfalls of growing too fast and losing the authenticity, heritage, friendliness of Fort Worth.
Well, I think that's a great point. We're going to get into that in a little bit in terms of the heritage piece with Craig. First, Mike, I'm going to come to you. If you talk about big ideas, I think you'd be hard-pressed to find one bigger than the notion of 27,000-acre master plan community due north of Fort Worth. It was aptly, shamelessly plugged. Reed twice, but it was really like 15 times. Well done.
Reed was doing his job.
Yes, sir. Mike asked me on the side, how's Reed doing? I said, he's great. He's on shameless plug number 400. He's great. He's doing a great job. You had a front row seat to it from the beginning. So talk to us about behind the scenes, what it's like. How does that big idea come to be in the context of why Fort Worth?
Just piggybacking on a couple of the comments. First of all, I think Laura should start focusing on another office building in downtown Fort Worth. We're ready for a new one. It's a no-brainer, right? I think the other theme that Isaac and Crawford picked up on, and Craig, like myself, sort of enjoys the same relationship with longtime family, Fort Worth families that like real estate and or control large pieces of land have really dictated and shaped a lot of the future of the past and the will shape the future of the city. We're very fortunate. That's a unique attribute of the city that is continuing to drive economic development. Just, you know, I can't give the evolution of Alliance in a 2-minute response, but I would tell you it was a series of sort of visionary and opportunistic things that came our way, but it started with Ross Perot Sr., Ross Perot Jr., who are natives of the region, primarily Dallas. But they looked at the growth of Dallas-Fort Worth, North Texas, back in the mid-'80s and said, you know, Dallas can't continue to grow north. DFW is the hub of our ecosystem, and Fort Worth will be the long-term growth city of the region. They saw that, you know, 40 years ago. And so they bought thousands of acres of land along 35W before anything had begun to happen. And a fun story that ties to Craig and the stockyards, the reason that there had been no development north of 820 for years and years and years is because the stockyards, you know, were an active cattle operation. And the prevailing southerly winds that we enjoy here had a direct impact, or lack thereof, of development happening in the northern part of our city. And so when that ceased, that active cattle activity in the stockyard ceased, that began to sort of change the perspective of that. That's an interesting sort of fact about our growth patterns that nobody talks about. But anyway, they invested because they believed it would happen eventually. The airport idea came along completely out of the blue because the FAA was focused on expanding our aviation infrastructure, and they needed to put an airport in that zone north of Fort Worth. We happened to be a large landowner, and Ross was an aviation enthusiast. And I give him credit for really taking the idea of an airport and stretching it to the idea of an industrial airport and using that as a way to attract business and industry. But the bigger thing that happened that has been a jump start to our growth from the early years was the Burlington Northern Santa Fe Intermodal Hub, because that then tied an industrial airport freight hub in with a global inland port that tied us into Asia and all of the movement of goods from Asia into the U.S. That's really what put us on the map. So I'd like to say that all this happened by design, but it really was, it was a series of things that caused it to happen.
And so what I heard there, and the takeaway from me is, you know, understanding the markets, understanding the potential growth that could be forecasted or could come, long-term bet, obviously, a little bit of luck along the way, which is always good in this business. But at the end of the day, knowing and understanding the market and what it could be, and then stretching and pushing, you know, again, as you referenced on the airport, you know, so that's a lot of things there. But when we talk about big ideas, it takes all of that. And again, as we get into this in greater detail, you're going to understand that there are all of those factors that are needed to be successful. Craig, we talked about the stockyards. I talked about it at length in the earlier panel. We're going to get into a lot of the details. You know, when I was, again, doing my research going back to 2014, when some of what I understand is the first conversations started to occur with Holt Hickman and company and others, fast forward 10 years, the number we discussed the other day when we met was 9 million visits this year forecast, stunning, up almost threefold just from a few years ago. You've directed over $1 billion in development throughout your impressive career. You're very bullish on Fort Worth. That's clear. That's obvious in our conversations, and not only in our conversations, but in what you're doing in the stockyards. So why Fort Worth for you? And then ultimately, let me parlay that into why have the stockyards been that successful in Fort Worth?
Well, for us, you know, we own, develop, manage, do all kinds of things, real estate. We have about 100 million square feet of real estate in our portfolio across the country, primarily industrial buildings and large big box, and we do that here in Fort Worth as well. But it's usually driven by the real estate, driven by the opportunity, sometimes public-private partnerships and such that leads us to those things. Rarely is it driven by anything much more than those fundamentals. And then we'll go off, and our company's been doing that for 75 years, and I've been doing it at the company for 30 years. So, fourth-generation Texan, I have an appreciation for all things Texas and culture and so forth. And this really started by invitation. It was by invitation by Holt Hickman, Brad Hickman early on. Brad's here today. Brad Hickman, and it really turned into, we saw an underappreciated asset in the stockyards. We saw, as you mentioned, 3 million visitors a year that were mainly tourists. We really didn't have locals going down there. That's where I tend to focus, is in mixed use, sports, entertainment, and hospitality, and the casino business as well. But I saw an underappreciated asset. I saw people looking for things to do. They were wowed by maybe the herd that went by for 15 minutes, and then they were looking for places to go. And while there's a lot of texture and there's a lot of buildings, there's 96 buildings in the historic district, there's very little content. So after you kind of experienced it for an hour or two and did a little few things, you would leave. And I think as a local, you kind of skip over that. You go out and do other things and you develop. And so by the invitation to take a look at that, really a generational shift in the stockyards, going from, let's say, the Murrins and the Jury family and Holt, going down to the next generation. There's only four generations of Hickmans in Fort Worth now. So it's going through a generational change, and they saw an opportunity to do something there. They didn't know what it was, but they knew they were not in the real estate development business. So we were invited to take a look. And I'll needle Brad a little bit here. I think he's still in the room, but he invited me to come down and share with him and Billy and Pam Minnick and the rest of the partners, Steve, give them some ideas and coaching on what they might do. The district's 200 acres. They controlled almost 100 of that and different ownership structures and such. And after my fifth or sixth trip, I said, I can't keep coming down here. I live in L.A. and I got projects in Nevada and California. I just can't come anymore. And I've given it. Call. I kept saying, call Hillwood. They can get it done. Or call Lincoln or Crow or anybody else. Call Crawford. Call somebody. But you're going to need a great public-private partnership. You're going to need a lot of patience. You're going to need some courage. You're going to need a lot of capital because everything down there is falling apart. As Betsy said, it was demolition by neglect. That was her quote. And Brad, I wish he hadn't done it, but he called me back and said, you know, one more thing. And I said, what's the one more thing? He said, I really want you to do it. Thanks for the coaching, but will you do that? You know, fourth generation Texan, a little bit of ego slipped in, never let that get in the way of business, but it did. And I said, okay, we'll take that on. And the punchline to that for us is it really, yes, it's about real estate. Yes, it was about opportunity. Yes, it was about trying to imagine here something for the future of the stockyards that could be better than it was. But ultimately, it got down to people. So why Fort Worth? It was not the city of Fort Worth. It wasn't the stockyards. It wasn't really the land or even the development opportunities. It was really the people. And I'm just quickly glancing around. I say it's about Betsy Price, who I don't think Betsy's in here today, but it's about Betsy saying, we're here to help you. It's about Mike Moncrief telling me, you got the unpolished gem there. It's your opportunity. Don't screw it up. He used a different word for screw it up, but that's Mike. Don't do that, and be careful with it. And it's going to take you a while to build, you know, some courage among the city and the Murren family and all these others that have put so much time and energy into it over the years. And then it was Maddie, and then Jay Choppa, and people who said, we're here to help you get it done, and we won't get in your way, but we're going to make sure you stay in your lane. And so why Fort Worth? It's the people. We're here because of people, and we made a commitment. They gave us their trust. We made a commitment to them, and we're 10 years into it. I thought we'd be done in five. We still have another five or six to go. So I'm sorry it's taken us so long, but we'll get it done.
Again, from the newest resident who was down there again last night, no apologies necessary from my perspective. Keep doing what you're doing. I'm going to come right back to you with a question in a minute, but I want to share a story real quick. We had a site selector, a consultant in town with a project that we've been working on for almost a year. We were down in the stockyards trying to close the deal. Took him down there for an experience. This is an international client, and the site selector pulled me aside outside after we stepped out of Letty's. And he said, I got to tell you, Robert, I'm really surprised. And I was like, oh, God, here it comes. And he said, this is really impressive. And I said, well, I'm really glad to hear that. We thought it would be impressive, but why is it impressive? And he said, I came in here expecting Nashville. And I said, I'm sorry, could you expound on that? What does that mean? He said, I expected drunk people in the streets, loud bars, you know, just kind of your commercial grade Nashville. And I said, okay, obviously you said it was positive, so what did you get? He says, this is family friendly, it's approachable, there's a family over there with a baby in a stroller, somebody, I won't tell you which one of the family is holding the beer in their hand. And he was like, everybody was friendly, everybody's been nice to me, everybody has been saying hi, howdy, how you doing? And I said, well, this is exactly the kind of fit and feel and people, as you talked about, Craig, that we have and we offer. And I asked him at the very end of the brief conversation, I said, so how do we not screw that up? And he said, tell everybody you can that this is what it feels like. Get them to come down here and experience it. So this is a bridge, Craig, to my next question to you. We've talked a little bit privately, but we've also talked a lot publicly. The previous panel did it. Authenticity matters in this city. It is authentic. If your word is given, your word is your bond, and it's followed through. You heard Isaac tell that great story earlier from the Edwards family. So growth is not always seen as positive, necessarily. It can come with challenges. You just said you've got about five more years to go. We know phase two and other things are coming. How do we stay true to the authenticity of Fort Worth with that development while still embracing growth as we move forward in a very quick-paced environment?
I think that, honestly, that's our greatest challenge. We didn't put on a business plan. I remember in the early days, I mentioned Jessica and I Susan, her sister, have been great partners with us down there. We did not say, let's figure out how to get from 3 million visitors to 9. We were trying to go 3 to 4, then 4 to 5, and then 5 to 6. So a lot of this is just luck. It just worked, and I don't know why. And we spend countless hours trying to figure out what the success ratio is there. And I'll say this about the people, too, and I think this is more about the city and the brand of the city and the Stockyards and the embracing of the locals and Highland Park Village. They're coming. Not Highland Park Village, but Highland Park and all that. They're coming over. The only thing we can deduce, and I think this was just a day or two ago, we were talking about this. Why is it that it has that, it's authentic, but it's a bit gritty, still has Stockyards, doesn't have the smell much anymore, but it does have, you know, we do the streets purposely to look old, and we use sand grout, not real grout, so it looks a little beat up. Well, why doesn't anything ever get broken? Nobody gets broken into. The neons don't get broken. You don't see broken bottles. You don't have people Nashville style on the street. And some of us are probably some of those people in Nashville when we go there. But when we come here, why is everybody's on their best behavior?
Yeah, so do that in Nashville. Don't do it in Fort Worth. Thank you.
But I don't. So it's just we keep wondering, why is it we don't have crime problems down there? What is happening? And after a couple of years of this, we were working on this, honestly, just in the last 72 hours. We concluded, this is our thesis, is that because we have such a large, of the 9 million, say 60% of those, 65% are from Texas. A lot of those are from DFW. We concluded that the only thing they could explain is they really take pride in what's down there as well. They're proud of this, and they're coming back next week, 2 weeks from now, 3 weeks from now. And I've spent a lot of time in Vegas. We have a casino there. There's plenty of the Nashville stuff, and you know what happens stays there, and you know, let it rip. People really respect the Stockyards, and I think, how do we grow? How do we take? We still have 30 acres to develop. We've only developed 4, 5. And somehow the whole place changed. Went from 3 to 9 with Mule Alley and Drover and Coliseum that we manage on behalf of the city. So we have a lot to do and a lot to build, a lot of vertical to do. And we don't want to go 9 to 15 million or 16 million or 17. We're fine with 9 if it stays like that. But we need to manage the brand carefully. We got to grow and do vertical real estate. We got to manage traffic. We got to manage safety. We got to manage the authenticity of it. How do you do that when it's new? Because really, Drover is the only new building. And it keeps us up at night. We're afraid of it. In some ways, I say, maybe we should just stop. Let's just let it go. But we've made the commitment to keep it going and keep going. So I don't have an answer for you. I'd tell you that's our greatest challenge, and we're losing a lot of sleep over it. But we're committed to move slowly and thoughtfully that we don't lose that. And the integrity of that brand, as it certainly ties back to the brand of Fort Worth, it's very important. In fact, it's required of us to do so.
Well, I think that's monumental. You know, we at FWEDP are new. We haven't even reached a year anniversary since, you know, I've been here putting my team together. And we talk a lot about, and for those of you that I've had the privilege to sit in front of and talk about our work, we talk about we are going to move slow. We are going to be thoughtful. We are going to be strategic. We're going to be focused to respect the authenticity and genuineness of this city. And that ultimately, as you point out, Craig, is a requirement of us. So if you're thinking about the next big idea out there and you have it, foster it, but also be required, if you will, to think thoughtfully and strategically and slowly through it. Because to bring that to fruition is going to impact, as each one of these individuals has done, Fort Worth in a very positive way. I think we've set a really, really good example of how that can be done. Mike, let's switch gears, if we will, a little bit. Let's take ourselves halfway around the world. And if you walked up to somebody on the street halfway around the world and you said, in one or two words, describe Fort Worth, Texas to me, my assumption is you'd probably get something cowboy or western along those lines. You probably wouldn't get mobility or transportation. Yet those are two key words, again, shameless plug, read, that came up multiple times on the earlier panel referencing Alliance, Texas, and the strength there. So why are those two key words so important to Alliance, Texas, and what you are doing there moving forward?
Well, if you look at the North Texas growth, historical growth, and look at our economy, a huge part of our economic growth over the years has been driven by transportation foundational infrastructure. I mean, we have DFW Airport. We're the second largest rail intersection in the United States. We're at the crossroads of the major interstate highway system. We're geographically central within North America. We're in the central time zone. All of that drives a lot of efficiency and economy for a wide variety of industry. And we sometimes forget that has driven a lot of our growth. We think about energy and oil and gas. We think about ranching and agriculture. We think about some of our historical parts of our economy, but you don't really think about transportation and mobility as a key driver, but it is. So, you know, we believe with all the change in technology that's going on around transportation and mobility now, automation, electrification, robotics, accentuated and accelerated by what happened in COVID and our supply chain disruption, we believe we can make North Texas and specifically Fort Worth the center for mobility innovation. If we build that story and if we are proactive. So that's what we're doing. We've created an alliance of mobility innovation zone. We talk about all the things I just said as to why here. We've begun to attract some of the early stage companies that and large globals that are working on developing commercialization of these technologies. And, you know, sort of a back to where we started, why has Fort Worth grown the way it has? I think we honor our past, but we're also pretty good at thinking about trends and future, and hopefully that will allow us to bring in a whole new round of industry, and you and I are working closely on mapping out a strategy for the whole city that will allow us to capitalize on that.
We are, and you know, I think it's important that the last panel finished with the notion that, you know, in the past it had been, you know, Fort Worth, Texas, and that was kind of, that was it. That was the comment, that was the word, and now it's evolved into these areas around the city that we talk about. Dare I say an ecosystem was a word that came up in our planning call. So I want to dig into that for a minute, Isaac, and talk to you. You know, just if you just look at this panel alone, and you start up north with Alliance, Texas, you come down through the Stockyards, you get to Laura's beautiful building in downtown Fort Worth, you start heading out west, we hit Clear Fork and all that the Edwards Ranch has become, and then ultimately you end up at Walsh Ranch on the Tarrant Parker line. Those are all individual stories, as we're talking about today, in their own right, but as you start to think about them in more of, dare I say again, Isaac's word, an ecosystem, you start to have a different, I think, view of the overall vision that is Fort Worth, Texas today, very different than what it was even 20 years ago, frankly. So, Isaac, talk about that for a minute. I know you agree with the term ecosystem because you were the one that said it on our planning call, but expound on that for us, because my experience has been people think about it singularly still. You know, when you're talking to people about Fort Worth, it's Stockyards are usually one of the first things you hear about. But it is not discussed necessarily as an ecosystem. Talk about that. Talk about how the importance of describing it that way and marketing that way, frankly, as we move forward, as somebody is thinking about the next big idea.
Yes, I'm going to put this in the context of sitting in front of a Fortune 25 battery cell CEO who happened to be Scottish, who ended up, because we suck in Texas with incentives, so they ended up in Kansas. But what's interesting about Fort Worth and why this is important is when we're selling Walsh to or Alliance or at Clear Fork or anything else, you know, I think the thing that differentiates Fort Worth from everybody else is in Dallas, it's every man for himself. Over here, we have investors that have breakfast at Clear Fork and then drive out to Walsh. If somebody needs a, when we were working on the Rivian deal, Rossborough Jr. and Mike said, what can we do to help you? Do you need foreign trade zone? Do you need, can we get the helicopter? How can we help you? We were trying to, you know, Robert and I were working to do a tour with a German group last week, and our problem wasn't where to, you know, we're just going to take them to the Stockyards. Our problem was, well, what about the medical district? What about the near south side? We've got so much cool stuff going on in Fort Worth that we didn't have 30 years ago that it's amazing. Our problem is editing and curating and growing. I had our multifamily partner had a bunch of Japanese investors coming in on Friday to do the tour. He goes, oh my God, where do I take them? And we were like 30 minutes into the call and he said, well, I've only got 2 hours. And I said, you should have scheduled a couple of days. Because if you really want to understand the ecosystem in Fort Worth, you've got to look at us as a total community, because our strength here, while this is the big idea panel, our strength lies in the people that went into Fairmount 35 years ago, bought houses, cleaned it up. The people that went, you know, Phyllis Tilly, who most of you guys don't know her, but she was a remarkable woman that built streams and valleys. She took us, the young guys, on a tour when we were in our 30s when we first got here, drove us down Magnolia and said, this is going to be the shopping street in Fort Worth. I'm looking around and going like, put the crack pipe down, because there is no way in hell this is going to be anything. But look at it. I mean, and think about just how far Fort Worth has come. When, Mike, when we were doing Taco Bell, what was that, 30 years ago, we could take them downtown because downtown was a block and a half. It isn't what it is today. So our ecosystem in terms of how we market Fort Worth, you know, the Koreans were going, you know, we're a little light on our Korean BS, but if you think about what, you know, we make the most advanced manufacturing aircraft in the world at Lockheed with only 18,000 people over there. Bell's just won another contract. American Airlines is the number one or two airline in the world, and we never talk about that as a Fort Worth project, but what do they spend on their campus? $1 billion. So when you think about everything that we have here as an ecosystem, the reason we're kicking other people's asses and we're the 12th fastest growing city in the country is because we've got it all here. And we are an ecosystem. We're not this aggregate deal thing. We are a community here, and that's what separates us. Have you guys been to Frisco lately? I mean, what the hell is that up there? I mean, I'm trying to find a place to go to lunch, and it's like strip center, strip center, center. They don't have what we have. Now, the corporate guys, that's an easy button, and site selectors, I hate them, but I love them. They can go check the box and get all their stuff sorted out, but when people come here, it's what Craig was talking about. This is a real place, and we have that real ecosystem here that differentiates us from, God help us, Austin or any other place in the country. And I just think it's important that we think about the big ideas, but also the incremental ideas of one person walking into a neighborhood and saying, you know what, I can fix this house. And that one action leads to remarkable change.
I told you I had thoroughbreds. That's the definition of a thoroughbred. So we're just all trying to keep up with Isaac. But let's take away from that the point, which is you can make a difference. You matter with your ideas. They could be singular in focus, or they could be ginormous, if that's a word, giant, gigantic. But it all starts with commitment to community and understanding the value and, again, the authenticity of Fort Worth, which it's special. I think it's very, very well said. Crawford, I'm going to come to you. First, a couple of definitions. The word big is defined, and I quote, of considerable size, extent, or intensity, end quote. And the word idea is defined, I quote, a thought or suggestion as to a possible course of action, end quote. So let's go back 176 years, I had hair back then, to when the Edwards Ranch was homesteaded. It was a year before Fort Worth was established as an army outpost on the banks of the Trinity River. I seriously doubt that your ancestors were scouting locations for a Neiman Marcus, but that is exactly what helps anchor the Clear Fork development today, and my wife and kids have spent a whole lot of time there. How does the Clear Fork development idea come about with the context of how long you, your family, and your ancestors have had the stewardship of that land?
Well, it would start with Lemuel J. Edwards, who settled on the banks of the Clear Fork River. And the reason he did may be of interest. Obviously, it provided water for livestock, had fertile soil along the river, had timber for homes. He was actually a home builder as well. Had upland to the south, upland, grassland was great, cattle country. So he and the following three generations continued to live an agrarian life, and fast forwarding today. Well, I'll just fast forward to 1956, when the city of Fort Worth was growing closer and closer to the fence line. Cassco Land Company was formed as a Sub S Corp to buy tracts of land from the owners and develop. And the very first thing they did, which looking back was really the genesis of the development, is they donated land for elementary school that is today Tanglewood, which is really the genesis and of the whole shebang. And today, I think I can speak for the entire family, we owe it to the generations that got us here, from Lemuel to Cass to Crawford and Cass. They, you know, Indians, depression, countless droughts, COVID, and they held it together. And we owe it to them, of all the blood, sweat, and tears they gave to that land. And we take that very seriously. I mean, I don't think we make, or at least I don't make any decision that I don't think about them. At the same time, I certainly need to look ahead to the current generation and future generations. And we really try to make our decisions based on the past, the present, and the future. As the family grows and more stakeholders, we have to, you know, squeeze the lemon a little harder to get more juice out of it. It used to be, you know, the just more shareholders. So really what we do at Clear Fork and our single family River Hills, we try to provide amenities and activities, whether it's retail, restaurants, river frontage to walk, you know, Pilates classes. We are constantly trying to determine what do people want? What do they enjoy doing? Are they casual and go to the river and work out? You don't have to be an athlete to go to the river and walk or go to the farmer's market. So we have that portion of the project. And then at the same time, we have, of course, where the Neiman's and luxury retail is. And we feel like we're offering a great range from those that can go to the high end and those that can go have free Pilates classes on Saturday. And so our goal is to really have a huge range of customers, you know, visiting Clear Fork and enjoying it. You may have heard the old adage. I can't remember what company it was, but I'll apply it to maybe our philosophy or mission is that we don't really actually own the land. We merely care for it for the next generation. And that's hard to explain sometimes to the younger generation, but that's what we do. And hopefully we continue, you know, developing projects that offer great amenities and conveniences and fun. And I'll end with this. We probably, or at least I, take it sometimes too seriously. We feel like when somebody comes and buys a lot from us in River Hills or Tanglewood in 1961, they have chosen to come to the ranch. And we take that very seriously. And what that means is, we are not perfect, is that we'll do everything we can to protect them from any other factors that could, whether it's somebody that's been in Tanglewood for 50 plus years or if it's at River Hills, we're going to be painstakingly detailed on, to a fault probably, I admit, to make sure that we live up to their expectations of coming there. And that is very difficult. I get a little heat from the office. Settle down, Crawford, settle down. I said, well, you don't understand. They have chosen to come, and by golly, we're going to do what we can. And I do some kind of strange, draconian things sometimes. I get a little personal involved in it. It's probably a fault, but it's just who I am. And again, looking back of how we got here and the responsibility we have for the next generations, it's just the right thing to do. So,
well, I think that dovetails beautifully with what Mike said earlier about respecting the past, but also trying to look forward to the future. And again, you know, I sound like a broken record. I apologize, but I think that's what makes Fort Worth special and unique. You don't find that in other cities. I'm a fifth-generation Texan. I love my state dearly. All of our cities, especially our large cities, are very different and very unique. They all have their own feel and fit. Fort Worth is very different, very unique, very authentic, and very genuine. And that is resonating clearly in the number of people that have moved here, the number of people that visit. And so, Crawford, your thoughtfulness resonates very, very loudly. Laura, I'm going to come to you. Let's talk about the office market. We talked about it a little bit before on the previous panel. It remains in flux. I heard maybe Tuesday to Thursday was the new work week canon. Is that what I heard, right? Tuesday to Thursday?
Monday to Friday.
I want to make that clear. Mike, mine's Tuesday to Thursday. I'm just doing what Cannon told me to do. But I do think there is still very much a question mark in the office space across this country in terms of demand and how big. We talked about corporate reloads earlier a little bit on that panel. They are definitely down. They remain down. Just to put a little context for everybody in the room, if I were to talk about that other city to the east, which pains me to do sometimes, but they had one big hit last year, one, in the corporate reload space. And it came late, September, October, if my math is right. That is severely off in terms of what their historical numbers have been. So let's talk about office. You live it every day. You built one. How do we keep people in downtown? Question number one. And then how do we get more people to downtown? Question number two, Laura.
So I think a lot, and I'm going to tag on to what everybody else has said, the public-private partnerships are so important. The chamber and their economic development, DFWI, Visit Fort Worth, all of those entities are extremely important to keeping our city where it is. The city governance, making people feel safe, having an easy time sitting out on a patio and not being accosted by passersby. Those are the kind of things that I think people are looking for, and other markets are failing in that because they are not supporting their police, and the government is not supporting the city's not supporting what needs to be supported to make those environments comfortable for tenants to be in. I think also the diversity of ownership is pretty important for downtown and driving the people into downtown. And that's, I'm talking about residential. I think that's an important part, which we're doing a great job getting more and more residential with the Deco 969. Arts and entertainment is a big part of having people downtown at all times of the day and night. And then education, what Texas A&M is doing, but we need more than just Texas A&M. We need the high schools. We need public transportation to be able to get these people around without having to use their car to go across town. So I think it's the transportation part of it in and around downtown, and then also out to the other districts, that transportation getting up to the Stockyards, getting up to Alliance, getting down to Clear Fork. Those are important things that if you can have those places and hubs that move the people without having to then have parking garages that kind of mar your city infrastructure, I think that's an important thing to driving more people and the feel and the community of a downtown.
Again, spot on, and I think it's important as you move forward to talk about these other factors that sometimes don't, you know, come up immediately in conversations. Mike Hillwood made headlines before the end of the year announcing the purchase of a block in downtown Fort Worth, first time Hillwood has invested in that way in downtown. So what big ideas may be on the table? What's swirling around in the conversations about what we might see come out of the ground with that site?
Well, I just sort of echo the things that Laura just went through. Look at what's happening in downtown Fort Worth, and there's negativity in perceptions out there about downtown because of what's happening in the office sector and yada, yada, yada. But
we'll just leave that right where he left it.
But it all of those projects that Laura just mentioned, including the expansion of the Omni Hotel and the Convention Center, if you add all the new investment that's happening in downtown Fort Worth, it totals $1.3 billion. Now, I don't know. I haven't done a U.S. major city CBD comparison, but I doubt there is any other city in the country who has currently $1.3 billion of new investment in their central business district. can't imagine, including Manhattan. And they're going the other way, by the way.
I think the Gucci building sold for $1 billion yesterday. Did you see that?
Oh, did it?
Downtown. Single building, $11,000 a square foot.
Jeez.
Just for you real estate hacks out there. $1 billion for a Gucci store. They bought it themselves. But, sorry to interrupt.
Yeah, okay. Well, then that doesn't count. I do think the driver of downtown is going to be residential versus office. I mean, we'd all love to see more office development, but quite frankly, unless a company shows up and drops in one of our laps, nobody's building an office building. You can't finance a spec office building today in the suburban markets, much less in the urban core. So you're going to have to, that's going to have to be demand driven. But I do think residential coupled with convention activities, coupled with A&M's campus, coupled with the expansion of other sort of tourism things, can drive a lot of activity in downtown, even without office. So, yeah, I would say we don't have a specific development plan yet. We're sort of watching all these things and talking to a lot of people. But I would say residential would be at the top of the list of the lowest hanging fruit asset class wise. Office, once again, we'd love to do office, but you got to have a user. I think there's another hotel opportunity, maybe downtown in a different niche, maybe, you know, a little more upscale, possibly combined with some residential component, hotel and for sale condo or hotel and something residential. So all of those are on the table, but we're just watching right now, and we're talking to a lot of people, and we want to help drive growth all over the city. We're expanding our vision in Fort Worth. We've been here for 35 years investing a lot of real equity and sweat equity, and it doesn't make sense for us not to continue to be part of the growth of the city.
We've got about 15 minutes or so here, so I'm going to try to get to two more questions if I can. Craig, I'm going to come to you. You talked briefly earlier in the discussion about kind of where you are in the life cycle of the Stockyards project. As you move forward in the future development that's in front of you, and it sounds like there's plenty left to do, lessons learned from where you started to today that are going to impact your decisions moving forward, do you feel like you may have to go a different direction based on what you've learned this far? Or are you going to stay the course and continue on with maybe what we've seen come out of your previous work?
Well, I think, let me go back real quick. We started in 14, 15, 16, and even into early 17. What we experienced there was a lot of what I would call a delay in the development programming. And it wasn't self-inflicted. It was about rezoning at three separate times and dealing with folks who were afraid to see anything happen in the Stockyards. And we were afraid. We just didn't tell anybody. Everybody else told everybody, and we quietly kept smug. And Betsy said, keep your mouth shut, and let's just keep moving, and which she was good at. And so that time gave us more time to let it ruminate and said, what do we really need to do, and what do we do with these old buildings and such? So, yes, we learned a lot. We learned a lot from our guest personas. You know, back then we were getting 1,000-page research reports. Today we get daily iPhone tracking reports on what we're doing. So that's why we know who's there, when they're, what they're doing, further segregating them, different personas and such. We learned a lot about the hospitality business. I mean, Holt had built the AmeriSuites that then became a Hyatt Place that we bought into and manage. And we were, a guy was asking me last night, you know, how did you do the Drover? And so we were imagineering, what if we could do 10% better than the Omni on rate? What if we could do a little bit better than this? What if we could do that? And we soared past that, not by pro forma, but just by, it just happened. And Drover certainly, and we welcome Iberge and Crescent into that same family. And maybe there's another tier or two. There's a lot of there. So where do we go with that? So we learned that there's a deep opportunity in the hospitality space. People want to be in the Stockyards. They'll pay a premium to do it, but they don't all need to be 4-star or 5-star. There's different tiers of that. So in our master plan, we have 15 acres and about 500,000 square feet of master plan that we're 30-40% into drawing right now. And it will require extension of public-private partnership and trying to bring vision to that. But it's not, I was thinking about your big idea. There's nothing left in the stockyards as a big idea. The big idea is the stockyards. We didn't build that. We didn't create that. We fell into it, and we did a bunch of little small ideas along. So really what the stockyards is a series of small, incremental, and accretive things that we can do. Some will be about driving revenue. Some will be about extending time on property, as we say in casino business, but time at the property, at the stockyard itself. It's not all about us. It's about East Exchange and West Exchange and North and South Main. You know, we have a whole ecosystem in the stockyards. And people are looking to us to say, what are you all doing next? It's been good for us over here. What else are you going to do? Someone asked me yesterday, how much do you spend marketing the stockyards here? We spend $5 million a year of our own capital, our own personal money, marketing the Fort Worth Stockyards brand. I think the whole CVB budget's $10 million in this town. And we spend $5 million just in the stockyards. Point of that is it's going to be careful and thoughtful. How far can you stretch the rubber band, as we say, of Western lifestyle? We've got a lot of the major Western lifestyle tenants down there, retailers. And now they're looking at ways, how do we change from a retail format into an experiential format? Maybe in phase two, we want to do something bigger that's got more tangible things that the customers can interact with our brand in. And that's where retail and experiential retail is going. And they need to figure that out. Ariat needs to figure it out. Wrangler needs to figure it out. Lucchese needs to figure it out. Others. Carhartt needs to figure that out if they want to be a part of it, things like that. We also have, talking about office, we have a couple of folks in the Western lifestyle space that I think would make sense having their corporate headquarters down there. And there's some in town that have outgrown space, or maybe their buildings almost fell down and they need to do something. But we wouldn't bring in anything other than Western lifestyle. You know, we're going to stay in our lane as long as we can, and you're not going to see a Lululemon store down there. We're not going to do that. And we have a list. We did a wonder wall. Jessica's not sitting there anymore, but one day she brought a list and said, we need to decide who we're not going to do, because we have to say no more than we say yes. And finally, I'll say that I'm going to leave room for others. Crawford, I really appreciate what you said there, and I thought we had actually patented that what you said, and now I learned that you've got the same deep spirit that we've sort of taken on in the stockyards. But my co-development partner down there, Kayla Wilkie, said one time, she goes, you know, and we were in front of a panel, I went, that was really good, and you just said the same thing. We don't really see ourselves as owning the stockyards. Even though we stand down there, I can't believe we own most of this. But we see ourselves as caretakers. And every decision we make is this room and is this city, and are a million people going to be proud of what we did? And if you came up from Austin, Houston, San Antonio, or you came in from Zermatt to visit, are you going to be proud of what you see? Did we meet your expectations? And are you going to recommend us to a friend to come back? And then you have to learn how to say no as much as you learn how to say yes, and we will not sell out. So we're with you. We're on the same page. Thank you, and I appreciate that.
Thank you. Yes.
I wrote it down, and you said it again. We have to say no more than we say yes. You know, that's difficult sometimes in the development, and certainly in the economic development business, when everybody wants me to say yes, let's go. We want a lot more deals, and we want a lot more corporate HQs, and we do, but we have to be thoughtful and strategic. Are they the right fit for this city? I won't be so bold as to go as far as putting myself in the stewardship category, because I'm not there. But my team and I talk often in our office about, and as we analyze deals that come to us, is this the right deal for Fort Worth, and is this the right deal, or is this a deal where Fort Worth would say, I'm proud to have it? And so, as again, for those of you that have talked to me, to talk to my team, you know we are being very, very thoughtful and strategic about the way we look at deals now as we move forward, because we do have that same mentality. Isaac, I've got 5 minutes or less. I have to put that marker out there. How has your development strategy?
Well, then I guess we can just leave the stage.
Well, yeah.
We'll leave it to you and Isaac to close it up.
Yeah. He's got to defend himself here.
Do I need to go to coach voice?
No, you don't. You're good. But a logistical point real quick. When we finish, though, do please all stay on stage while Joel closes things out. Thank you, Mike. Has your strategy changed? Has the wall strategy changed? Let's talk about that from day one to where we are today. There have been headlines through the paper about folks that have looked at opportunities there. You know, and so talk to me just briefly, and talk to the audience briefly about, have there been, you know, a change in strategy? Have you had to maybe go left when you thought maybe you were going to go right, based whether it's market demands, whether it's interest, whether it's client demands, et cetera, from day one to where we are today with the project?
Look, day one for me was 2020. Walsh was a residential project. Everybody thought it was, you know, white houses in the middle of the prairie. RPG was running around representing the brand. and nobody really thought about 7,500 acres. My job for them has been to accelerate infrastructure, and it's the Alliance playbook that we did early on. You go elephant hunting because you can't get infrastructure delivered unless there is a reason for David Cook to make an investment in what you were doing as a landowner. Rivian forced everybody into the room to look at this 2,500 acre south of I-20 that had 7,700 residential units on it. The city could not have rezoned that faster to K-heavy industrial, then it would have blown your mind how efficient they were. The city, the state of Texas, and Tarrant County are investing $176 million in infrastructure for that region. We were scheduled to have freeway bridges, according to COG, on I-20 in 2048. They're going to be here in 2026. So the strategy change, Robert, was getting in the game and looking again back at that 24,000 acres of West Fort Worth and going, topo sucks out there. You're going to do residential on the majority of it. The Beal guys at P&B and Walsh have the opportunity to have some relatively flat dirt where we can either do big economic development deals or 12 million square feet. We've got 450 acres coming online right now. Call Matt Carthy. He's our broker representing. If you got a deal, bring it to us. Sorry, do I sound like Reed Getz? And then we've got 450 acres out there that's the best corporate campus site in America. But when the office comes back, it'll still be there because the Walsh family, very similar to what the Edwards have been doing, they're stewards of this land. I'm there to help them set the table for a 30 to 40 year run. And that's really been the strategy shift. We're not just, and we have some residents here, so thank you so much for living at Walsh. But our job is to create a community out there that is going to anchor that region.
Well, let's just wrap this up and remind everyone what we've heard today. Big ideas are about thoughtfulness. They're about planning. They're about being good stewards of what you have in your possession, about being mindful of what that may mean for Fort Worth as we move forward, keeping it authentic, keeping it genuine, keeping it real. You also heard, I did, they don't happen overnight. There's a lot of luck involved, Craig. I like that. As I say, my family, I'd rather be lucky than good, and that's true. But it's also about putting yourself in a position to capitalize on that luck. And that has certainly been a key theme of what I've heard through this conversation. So Joel's going to come up here and wrap us out. I'm going to ask everybody to stay on the stage that's up here with me. But before we do that, please join me in giving them a round of applause.